Aye. Okay, nice. Hello, good evening, guys. My name is Muntasir. My friends call me Simon because my name is quite difficult to be pronounced by people in Singapore and in yes. So I'm going to present things that I know in life science, but it is not authoritative knowledge because it is based on my 2 years experience, or my last 2 years experience as a software engineer for Thermo Fisher Scientific, biotech company. And all of things that I present in this slide are my personal opinion. It does not represent opinion of Thermo Fisher Scientific. I have to mention this because when I told my boss about this, he makes me mention this. And
you must mention this.
Yeah. And I also have a very small investment at some biotech company, so maybe I have a slight personal bias that about some product or technology.
This is also required from your
boss. No.
But do you have to declare that to your company that you have investment on another biotech company?
Yeah, below a certain amount. I don't. Yeah. So this is the domain. Our domain knowledge is mostly on the living organism. Living organism. So we work from our client are working on from molecule up to living organism. So
not necessary human.
Animal, also animal, plant, and also single cell, such as single cell organism, such as bacteria, virus, protozoa, just like that.
Organism.
Yes, including single cell organism. So, but my company usually develop chemicals and consumables. Usually we develop product to support our client that work on cell and chromosome and gene. Some of our client also work on on molecule and macromolecule. So most of them are biochemists and molecular biologist and also geneticist. So this is the high level overview of living organism structure. So at the lowest level is atom, and then the upper level of is molecule, such as ion, such as oxygen, water, hydrogen, and then things like that. And the upper layer of molecule is macromolecule. Macromolecule in this term are protein. And then the upper layer of macromolecule is organelle. Organelle is organ of a cell. So within a cell, there are some organelle. And the upper layer of organelle is cell. And the upper layer of cell is tissue. Tissue is a collection of cell. And a collection of tissue makes an organ. And organ, some organ makes a system. in this illustration, this is a digestion system, and then some system makes living organism. So this is the high level overview of a cell. So within a cell, there is a nucleus in here, and then within nucleus there are chromosome, and then within chromosome there are DNA, the smallest unit of information, hereditary information. So mostly we
there's a gene there on the DNA string.
Gene is a part of chromosome, because this chromosome, the chromosome is actually very long. There are in human genome, in a human chromosome, the longest chromosome are comprised of 200 million DNA. 200 million is 2 with 8 0. This one DNA, there is a 200 million.
Mm-hmm.
Within one chromosome. Yeah. So. Yeah. So we can consider this chromosome like
so
a.
One body like this is.
Yes.
200 million.
Or trillion probably. Yeah. So in every cell, in all our body has this nucleus, has this chromosome, and its chromosome comprised of 1,000 million and hundreds of million DNA. And human genome comprised of 23 chromosomes. So, yeah, this is the image on the left. This is a chromosome. The image on the right is the length of each chromosome.
Hmm.
Yeah. 23 chromosomes. Yeah. Yeah. So this is the first chromosome. The second, 3, 4, and 5. So this is the. For male has male has a slightly different chromosome than female. Female had the 23rd chromosome for female is XX, but for male, the 23rd chromosome is XY, I guess. Yeah, so this is a small video. Oops, like this. Yeah.
Humans are all living tissue. In most human cells, there is a structure called a nucleus. The basic unit of all living tissue. In most human cells, there is a structure called the nucleus. The nucleus contains the genome. In humans, the genome is split between 23 pairs of chromosomes. Each chromosome contains a long strand of DNA, tightly packaged around proteins called histones. Within the DNA are sections called genes. These genes contain the instructions for making proteins. When a gene is switched on, an enzyme called RNA polymerase attaches to the start of the gene. It moves along the DNA, making a strand of messenger RNA out of three bases in the nucleus. The DNA code determines the order in which the three bases are added to the messenger RNA. This process is called transcription. Before the messenger RNA can be used as a template for the production of proteins, it needs to be processed. This involves removing and adding sections of RNA. The messenger RNA then moves out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm. Protein factories in the cytoplasm, called ribosomes, bind to the messenger RNA. The ribosome reads the code in the messenger RNA to produce a chain made up of amino acids. There are 20 different types of amino acids. Transfer RNA molecules carrying the amino acids to the ribosome. The messenger RNA is read 3 bases at a time. As each triplet is read, a transfer RNA delivers the corresponding amino acid. This is added to a growing chain of amino acids. Once the last amino acid has been added, the chain folds into a complex 3D shape to form the protein.
Cool. Now we've got protein.
Yeah, that's it. That is
the high-level overview about the purpose of chromosome. So the chromosome is a template to create, to produce a protein. Because protein are being used by our cell to make a tissue, things like that, yeah, to regulate things. Yeah, so this is the high-level overview of the DNA chromosome and protein. So basically the purpose of chromosome is to create protein. Okay. So I'm working on, so life science actually has a lot of discipline, but what I think the most popular in biotech or in life science is genomics and bioinformatics. So the genomics is the genetic is an area that concern about sequencing and analysis of organism genome, and bioinformatics is the interdisciplinary field that use software tools to understanding this biological data. And in bioinformatics, we use a lot of computing power. We use many software to understand this biological data, especially genome data and also protein data. And then, so the one of the interesting problem in biotech is to sequence the chromosome, because the size of chromosome is very small. It is as you see that the size of chromosome is only 10 micrometer, so it is actually very difficult to see this chromosome in action. So we have to work indirectly through enzyme and these chemicals and things like that to see it. And then to sequence the DNA itself, it costs us a lot of money. The first human genome sequencing takes 13 years to sequence it. And then it costs several countries, you see that, 2.7 billion for 10 years. But now in 2016, it only costs us $1,500 US, yeah, to have the full genome sequence.
Why do we need to sequence genome? What's the purpose to
sequence the genome? Because by by knowing our genome, so for normal life, for healthy people, probably there is no immediate need to understand our genome. But for sick people, for cancer, for people who has cancer, or for people who has dependencies on.
The same medicine that you take, I take, he takes, everyone takes. But my genome is different from yours, it's different from yours. So if you know your genome, you can have a specific medicine for you that you're going to go straight for your problem. So that's different from mine, from his, and so on. So that's, if you understand each one, you can have specific medicine, not generic ones as you have today.
Yes, exactly. When you say 2 days, like, take a scenario that if I give a blood like this, then I pay $1,005 within 2 days, I can get my sequence. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
This is for the full sequence. If you, there are companies that they do for $100, but it's not the full sequence, right?
Yeah.
And you can have cheaper.
Yes. There is a cheaper version of this for the sequencing. Yeah, but probably in near future, probably we can have this full genome sequencing in probably in cheaper, will cost us cheaper. So I'm going to show you so this is the state-of-the-art DNA sequencing instrument. The price of this instrument is $10 million, and the running cost is $1,500. By running cost is to sequence, let's say, to sequence a human genome.
So your company has those machines there?
No, this is the Illumina is our competition. Competitor. Competitor. No, this is our competitor. Many researchers dream to have this sequencing instrument at their lab. So this is my company product. Ion S5 XL. The price is much cheaper.
Yes.
And
why the running cost is higher than the first one?
Because of the consumables. Because this business is quite similar to printer inkjet. So usually we sell this printer to our client, and then to run that instrument, our client needs consumables, chemicals and consumables.
You need to add something in order to do the sequencing.
Yes.
From the material to the beads, right?
So okay.
You need some keepers.
Yes.
That's what you mean by that.
Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah. So most of our profit comes from consumables, from chemicals. it is very similar to printer business. Something like that. Oops. It's being recorded. So we try to lower the price of instrument to make it so many researchers can afford to buy this, so they can buy a lot of consumables and chemicals.
So it means that, like, to do a sequence, you will let the machine run for 2 days.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. And this kind of instrument can run for the whole year or something.
So usually, which institution that buying this machine? Is it hospital or
labs? Usually labs. Government funded lab, something like that. Yeah.
150 is cheap.
Yeah, 150 is cheap. Yeah, And this is a much smaller version of DNA sequencing. They call it, this is a British company, Oxford Nanopore. Their product is Minion. The sequencing instrument itself is only $1,000.
Running cost.
Yeah, because this is a prototype.
Oh.
This is a prototype also. We are still not sure how much does it cost. So this is a one-time usage. So we put these samples and chemicals into this instrument, and then it will sequence this genome and send the data to the laptop, and then the laptop will send the data to the cloud.
Oh.
And then the cloud.
So it means you can run in your home, right? So
you yes.
Yourself,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. So in near future, we can have this DNA sequencing instrument.
To let you run for how many hours of this?
I don't know. Probably, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
So is the result 100% accurate?
No, unfortunately, the error rate of this instrument is quite high. Around error rate is around
30%.
30%. Yeah.
So if you run all device together, you can get different results.
Yes, different results.
Oh.
So accuracy. This instrument and this instrument has much better accuracy. So yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is another.
He is the most interesting pathologist in the world, and I would like to talk to you about next generation sequencing. The process begins with genomic DNA, but the DNA is far too long to be sequenced, so it must be broken into smaller pieces. This is.
Okay, so this video is about how the DNA sequencing instrument works. This is a simplified version of the DNA sequencing instrument, how the DNA sequencing instrument works. And this video is quite funny too, so, but it is quite accurate.
And I would like to talk to you about the next generation sequencing. The process begins with genomic DNA, but the DNA is far too long to be sequenced, so it must be broken into smaller pieces. This is done by a sonar pulse, so we will need a sound so unpleasant it can actually shatter DNA. Ah, thank you very much, Chester. Now, the DNA must be split into two strands, that is denatured. It is then hybridized to a surface, either a bead or a solid plate. Now, I do not wish to favor one platform over another, so instead, we will hybridize to Chuck Norris's beard. It's a spherical Chuck Norris, but still, sexy nonetheless. The DNA fragment is then amplified in either an emerging PCR reaction or an isothermal bridge amplification reaction. Yes, these are very, very big words indeed, but just watch the video. Here is some music for you.
Overview how the DNA sequencing instrument works. So the DNA sequencing instrument has a camera, a computer with camera that capture that image, that light. So different light represent different DNA nucleotide. So that's how the instrument knows this DNA type. Yeah.
So the light emitting, then there will be a camera.
Yeah.
Capture the one, so it will get your sequence like just on the XY, the picture.
Yes.
Oh.
Not the XYZ, the A, C, G, T.
Yeah. Mm. And then,
So, and then
we use software to analyze the image. Yeah. Then we use software to analyze the image, and then we generate a text file.
Text file.
Yes, text file. As a result of this.
Python processes text file.
Yeah.
And image processing is done using Java, is it?
So it depends on the operating system. So for example, Thermofisher instrument use Android operating system. So we use Java. Yeah.
Android OS.
Yes, Android OS. Yeah. Customized version of Android. Yeah. I'm working on that part.
You guys had for Android, so why pick Android?
Any specific? Because it is easier to find Android developer compared to
iOS.
Qt.
And then it is quite difficult to find C or C++ developer. And then, yeah.
My company got people to do image analysis, but C++.
Yeah. See.
But not this kind. Another kind of image analysis. Building.
I see. Okay, and then the second big problem in life science, in biotech, is huge data set, because for human chromosome comprised of 3 billion DNA, we call it 3 billion base pair, because each DNA has usually are in a pair. Yeah, cytosine and guanine, adenine and thymine, yeah, something like that. And then there is one human genome, right? And then if we have 1,000 people, then we will have billions of billions data. So we have a big data problem here. How to efficiently analyze and translate this data into useful information. And then, so we use this data for genome-wide association studies. So, and then we also use this data for cancer research, because for cancer disease, our own cell has several thousand chromosome mutation, around from several thousand up to 70,000 chromosome mutation. Yeah, so for genome-wide association study, we try to find the correlation between genotype information and its phenotype. So for blue eyes, we try to find which part of that chromosome that contribute to that, for example, blue eyes color, black eyes color, skin color, and things like that. So we use this genome-wide association study to find the correlation between genotype and phenotype. Phenotype is the expression of genome in human. Because there are several diseases that are based on genome, such as diabetes, and then arthritis, rheumatoid, and things like that. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so this is the software stack in the instrument for Thermo Fisher product. Mostly we use Android and we use Java programming language. And we use Linux because the Linux is the underlying native operating system of Android. And for some legacy product, we use Qt framework. And for genomics, for bioinformatics product, we also develop software to analyze instrument output. So we use JavaFX, we use Spring framework. Yeah. And then we also use RDBMS and NoSQL database. And for web-based application, we also use Java Servlet, Spring Framework. Oh, sorry, it is wrong. The Eclipse RCP is not correct. Yeah. And then RDBMS and Amazon S3 database. Yeah. This is, yeah, so we use a library called BioJava to represent a genomic model and to represent a proteomic model, to represent this protein data and to represent genomic data. We use a library called BioJava. And for the UI part, we use JavaFX, Swing, yeah, the MMS. Okay, so this is the player, big player in the sector. Yeah. Instrument maker, for example, this is Thermo Fisher Scientific. The company value is 61 billion, slightly below Uber. Uber has greater company valuation with 50,000 employees around the world, founded in, yeah. Yeah, quite old. Yeah. So actually, this company are the result of merger of several companies. Yeah, 2 years ago, it acquired Life Technologies. And another company is Illumina, the maker of that state-of-the-art DNA sequencing instrument, the one that you saw this, the 10 million DNA sequencing instrument. That is the company, quite young. Mm-hmm. With 7,000 employees and 4 billion market capitalization. And pharmaceutical company, for example, Roche, with market capitalization 220 billion, this is a big player, 91,000 employees, yeah, founded more than 100 years ago. And also the innovative company, quite young, Regeneron, yeah, 37 billion, 4,300 employee. Yeah. And this is a biotech startup. For example, a subsidiary of Alphabet, Google, the Calico Labs. Yeah, they're quite small company. Yeah. So they focus on the aging, age-related disease, and cancer research. The other biotech startup is Human Longevity Incorporated, founded by Craig J. Venter. Craig J. Venter is a pioneer in DNA sequencing, full genome sequencing. It has office in Singapore, yeah. But it uses C# for its application, not Java. Yeah, 500 employees. Yeah, they focus on genomic and cell therapy. Yeah. No. Yeah. So this is what is the future? What is the important skills for software engineers in life science or in biotech company? So I think, in my opinion, data science and statistics, because we have to help scientists, our immediate client, to understand to finding new genes in chromosome. Also, we have to help them to clean the data from the instrument. We have to clean it out, filtering and things like that. And then we have to present it in a meaningful way. For example, this is the chromosome data, and then yeah.
This is
No, not really. This is a simplified high-level overview for executive level.
So do you use any out-of-the-box tools to visualize this software, or you have a custom software to do it?
Yes, we use the existing library to customize it. Yeah.
It's not, you cannot use like Tableau or
Oh yes. Yes, most of the job advertising in this for bioinformatics job, most of company require this SaaS product.
SaaS.
SaaS. Yeah, SaaS product. Yeah, I think another important skill is the machine learning. Because the instrument use a camera, right, to get the data, and during this calibration or during the interpretation, probably we can make this machine smarter to find the data. So this is an example of the output of the machine. This one at the bottom.
The camera.
This is the image file. Yes, image file. See that? So we have to end up.
Then from there, they will produce the upper image.
Yeah. No. The upper image is slightly different tools, different instrument. Yeah. No. This is a smaller version. I mean, because we can also. Yeah. Actually, this is a much higher resolution image, actually. This is a smaller version of this. The image itself is quite big. Yeah.
So how do you decolorize that? It's colors, right? So you have different colors there. So how you, this is the, when you take the picture, so the colors are itself in the gene, or you put those there?
No, the colors itself is emitted by the chemicals.
Chemicals.
So for thermovisor, the chemicals, there is an R&D center in Eastern Europe who work on these chemicals. In Singapore, we work on hardware. Instrument, so different, but at the US side they know it all. They know it all. But yeah, so yeah, unfortunately I do not know much about the chemical itself.
That's fine. The chemical will let the light come out.
Yes.
Different color for different time.
Yes, different color. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then the hardware will respect the picture to understand the color and
yes.
come out the signal.
Yes. And interpret the result.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, I think that's all. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's all.